Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Madhuparna Roy Choudhury. I teach Ancient Indian History and Culture in the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. Today I am going to talk on the subject of Indian culture, and the paper name is Social and Cultural History of India from the Earliest Time to 1707 AD, and the module is Social and Cultural Life as Depicted in the Epics and the Puranas. Before I come to the main points of this module, let me give you a small idea, brief summary of what we are going to discuss in this particular module. Actually, the two great Indian epics and the Puranas are vast repository of important sources of Indian history, and they contain a very important socio-religious and cultural, you know, aspects of Indian history. They are also important sources of polity, but besides dealing with polity, they also cover important aspects of socio-cultural history of India, which we are going to discuss in this particular module. Now, I'll come to the learning objectives. What are the objectives of dealing with this with this particular module? We are going to acquaint our students with the main characteristics of the epics and the Puranas, and how far they are useful in understanding, in treating, in getting accepted as source materials for knowing the society and cultural life of India. And at the same time, we'll discuss how the epics and the Puranas are problematic to be considered as important sources. So we are going to talk about the difficulties of treating them as sources, as well as the significance of them as source materials of Indian culture and Indian society. Before I come to the main points, I'll give you a small introduction. We are all aware of the very two important epics of India, which are Ramayana and the Mahabharata. You know, Ramayana and the Mahabharata, as well as the Puranas, they constitute two very important genres of Brahminical narrative traditions of India. Now, these two texts, these two types of texts, that is the epics and the Puranas, they are considered to be the fifth Veda, and they are also classified as Sthiti texts. So what do we mean by Sthiti texts? Sthiti texts are those texts which are ascribed to human authorship. That means we presume that the epics and the Puranas were the creations of human authors, human sages or seers of the ancient times. And these are not comparable to the Vedic literature, because the Vedic literature are Stutis, because we think that they were not created by human beings and they were emanations from the God himself. So there is a difference between the Sthiti texts and the Stuti texts, and the literature that we are going to talk about, that is the epics and the Puranas, they are part of the Sthiti kind of literature. Now the question is, while we are engaging with the task of gleaning history from the epics and the Puranas, there is a very big problem, because myths and legends and story elements have been intruded in the epics and Puranas in a large extent. And just because of that, historians find it very difficult to glean accurate objective history from these two genres of texts. So this is also a very important problem that is actually associated with these two genres of texts. Now the character. First, I'll talk about the epics, then I'll go into the Puranas. So while we are talking about the epics, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, let me give you an idea about the character of these two Indian epics. First of all, both these epics, Ramayana and Mahabharata, had an oral origin. And we also consider it to be birdic origin. What do we mean by birdic origin? That means these were created by birds. Birds means we have a term for the birds, that is the shutas. The shutas means birds, that is the oral narrators or the oral composers who had created the epics. And initially, they were known as Jayagatha or the Viragatha. Why? Because they dealt with the tales of wars. That is why they were known as Jayagatha or the Viragatha. And you know, the epics in the beginning, when they were actually orally composed, they had a secular character. They were not given a religious character in the beginning. They actually gave us sense of a distant past. And this kind of literature, that is the epic literature, were known as Akkhano type of literature. And this Akkhano, along with Purana, created the nucleus of what is known as the Itihasa Purana tradition of history. And this kind of literature, that is the Akkhano literature, they were different from religious scriptures called Agamas. And they were also different from scholarly treatises called the Shastras. So as we have already discussed, they were not religious in the beginning. They were secular. So they were different from Agamas and Shastras. And you know, the Akkhano and Purano, they are seen as the inspired words of ancient sages in simple heroic verse, which lacked the romantic or stylistic features of Kavya. Now, coming to the authorship. So we have to discuss the authorship of the epics as well. You know, with regard to the great epic, Mahabharata is usually considered to be the great epic of India, and the Mahabharata, Ramayana, is known as the little epic of India. So the Mahabharata, the great epic, was actually authored by, it is actually said in tradition that Krishna Dwaipayon Bash was the first person to have sung the happenings of the great war of Kurukshetra. So Krishna Dwaipayon Bas is considered to be the first author of Mahabharata, and later on the Mahabharata was composed in the hands of sages like Lomoharsho, Ugrashrobha. We have several names actually associated with the authorship of Mahabharata. You know, it was composed in the beginning, it had 8,000 slokas, and it was then the number of slokas had actually added to 1 lakh. It actually amounted to 1 lakh. At the ending, around about 750 BC, the epic got its final shape in the hands of Lomoharsho and Ugrashrobha. It is considered to be in that way. Now, coming to the authorship of Ramayana. You know, when we are talking about the authorship of these two great epics, that is one Mahabharata and the other Ramayana, we must remember one point, that the authorship of Mahabharata is always shrouded in mystery. We are not certain about who exactly was the author of Mahabharata. But with regard to Ramayana, we have a historical character, Valmiki, who is considered to be the author of Ramayana. He is known as the Adikavi, and his creation Ramayana is known as the Adikavya. So his historicity is proved. He is actually a historical character, Valmiki. Now, we have to talk in brief about the date of the epics as well. You know, this is also a very, very complex subject. You know, we just can't ascribe any particular date to the epics. We are not sure exactly when the epics were written, because we have already mentioned that they had an oral tradition. After being oral in nature, they were subsequently written down. So we really don't know when exactly the epics were composed, but we have a very large date. We can say, we can give a very, you know, lengthy date for the epics. With regard to Ramayana, it is from 1st century AD to 1st century BCE to 1st century CE. And with regard to Mahabharata, it's from 4th century BCE to 4th century CE. So it's a very long date that we can ascribe to these two great epics of India. Now, we are coming to the main topic of discussion, that is the social and cultural life as depicted from the epics. So, before I enumerate the main points of social and cultural life of the epics and the Puranas, let me remind you that what we have already discussed. We have already given you a brief discussion of the date of the epics, that it is difficult to come to a fixed date of the epics for both the epics. Then we have given you some idea about the authorship of the epics, and then we have actually tried to give you an idea about the problems inherent in the epics, as legends and myths have been vastly actually incorporated in the epics and thereby limiting their use as authentic historical sources. So with these words, now we are going to talk about the way the epics can give us some information about the social and cultural life of our country. Now, discussion on the social milieu of the epics necessitates a perusal of two very principal phenomena of a social structure. What do we mean by two very important factors of social structure? One is the extent of caste differentiation discerned in the social life of the given period. And the other is the condition of women. So while I'm talking about the social life, I'll be emphasizing on these two points, that is the extent of caste and the condition of women as existed in that time. So basically, while we are talking about the caste system as depicted in the epics, we find that the epics actually during the course of its creation had given us some information about the caste system. Before I come into the details of caste system, let me give you an idea of how the epics were actually have two distinct components in that. You know, the epics, particularly with regard to Mahabharata, two chapters, one is the Shanti Parva and the other is the Anushasana Parva. That is the 12th chapter and the 13th chapter, they were composed at a much later date. And therefore, these two chapters in Mahabharata and in with regard to Ramayana also, we have similar two chapters, Balakanda and the Uttarakanda. These two chapters actually were added at a later time. So in the beginning, we are going to talk about the interpolations. What do we mean by interpolations? By interpolations, we mean that the epics continuously underwent changes. Because I have already mentioned you that in the beginning it had 8,000 slokas, at the end it had 1 lakh slokas. So we can understand that the epics, when it was in the oral form, the epics when it received the written form also, it kept on changing. So new layers were being added to the crux of the epic. Thereby, it is difficult for us to understand exactly the kind of nature the epic possessed, because it was composed over a very long period of time. However, from the portions that were added later on, which we are describing as interpolations, we are getting some information about the society, about the transition of the society. As I have mentioned, the epic has two distinct components. What is the distinct component we are talking about? These are the narrative part, or the core narrative, and the didactic part, or the pseudo narrative. You know, the core narrative is the story of the war, which was composed at the earliest time when the epic was formed. That is the core narrative. And the portions which were added at a later time, which had a number of moral, ethical parts in it, these are known as the didactic part. So from the didactic part particularly, we are getting very important ideas, insights about the development of the caste differentiated society, which we are going to talk about. So for our understanding, let us get into our head that we have two different sections. One is the narrative and one is the didactic. Now coming to the next point, we are going to discuss about two important authors on Mahabharata. One is Edward Washburn Hopkins. You know, Edward Washburn Hopkins was a Sanskritist. He was a British by birth, and he was the first scholar, first serious scholar, I must say, who had started a discussion on the importance of Mahabharata. He has some important works which he had written in the late 19th century. One is The Great Epic of India, and the other is The Social and Military Position of the Ruling Caste in Ancient India. In these two books, he has discussed us about how the epics has two different parts. And he has also informed us that the core epic is the story of the military fight, that is the war history, and the pseudo epic or the didactic part, which was added at a later time, which I have already mentioned to you, that is the Shanti Parva and the Anushasana Parva in the Mahabharata. These were known as pseudo epic or the didactic portions, because these were added at a much later time. So Hopkins was the first person to give us an idea about these two different sections in the epic. Now after Hopkins, we are mentioning one very important modern day scholar. Her name is Romila Thapar. We all know about her. You know, Romila Thapar has written a number of works, of which in the book Cultural Past, she has written very few essays on the epics, that is on the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. And she has also reiterated the point raised by Hopkins. She has also mentioned that this Mahabharata has undergone, you know, series of changes. There were layers of additions to it, and how the Shanti Parva and the Anushasana Parva are useful for understanding the long-term changes of society and polity in early India. So Romila Thapar has also to be taken into account. Now, while we have given you a model about Mahabharata, let us also talk about Ramayana. What are we seeing with Ramayana? Is Ramayana also following the same pattern? It is true of Ramayana as well, because Ramayana is a lesser epic. Certainly, it is much lesser in size compared to Mahabharata. But in Ramayana also, we find some later additions. You know, the books 2 to 6 were written at an earlier time, and book 1 and 7, that is Balokando and Uttarakando, these were added at a much later time. So with regard to Ramayana also, we are finding two different components, that is the narrative and the didactic. And here, you know, the language structure, the kind of literary style that we find in Ramayana, the later sections of Ramayana, those are also quite advanced compared to the earlier section. We find Professor Robert Goldband, who is a linguist, he has offered us this kind of linguistic interpretation while he has talked about this kind of incongruence in the writing of the Valmiki's Ramayana. So, now coming to the next point, we are going to talk about the way the sarmas give us some information about caste history and gender history. Because we have already told you that while we are talking about the socio-cultural life of the epics, we have to take into account these two very important phenomena. That is how far caste history was there, how far caste differentiation was there, and how far gender, what kind of information we are finding about the position of women. So we are going to talk about that now. So what now, while I'm talking about sarmas, what do we mean by sarmas? Let me remind you once again that by sarmas we understand the moral lessons that were actually included particularly in the later sections of the Mahabharata. Now, in the Mahabharata, behind the sarmas, we find some important historical facts hidden. What are we meaning by historical facts? We mean that the kind of history that we are actually inquisitive about, that is how far caste differentiation was there. You know, let me give you an example from Anushasana Parva. You know, Anushasana Parva, as I've already mentioned, it was added at a later time. And here we find the Kshatriyas were getting importance, much more importance. How? Because they were given the charge of maintaining the Varna order. You know, they were the custodians of the maintenance of the Varna division of the society. And they were also asked to perform rituals to give more privileges to the Brahmins. So this small information helps us understand that in the society of all the Varnas, the Kshatriyas and the Brahmins were getting more importance. And now, coming to the second point, that is the position of women. What kind of position was there? What kind of liberty, what kind of position the women held in the society during the epic time? Here I'll give you two examples. One about Shakuntala and the other about Draupadi. You know, about Shakuntala, we find in the Adi Parva, in the earlier section of the Mahabharata, we find that she is actually depicted as a spirited woman who loves her liberty, who is an independent-minded woman, who stands up for a right, for the right of her son. And even she is convincing, Dushyanta. And she is trying to, argue with Dushyanta. So it shows that she was an upright woman. She was trying to stand up for her own right. But this kind of projection that we find with Shakuntala in the earlier part is missing in the later part. You know, in the later part, we find that Shakuntala has been transformed into a meek woman, into an obedient woman. You know, she is trying to convince her husband about the importance of married life, about the importance of the duties of parents towards their children, about the importance of husbands towards their wives, and this and so on and so forth. What is the significance of this? So we can understand that somehow the writers of the later part of the epic were trying to subdue women, and these sections where we find that women are subjugated compared to men, these were to a large extent influenced by the Dharmashastra texts of the time, of which we are going to discuss a little bit later. Now coming to the question of Draupadi. Even with regard to Draupadi, there is a very, very important transformation that is taking place in her character. We are all aware, this is a very famous, narrative, that is the game of dice. We know that she was dragged to the court and she was trying to be, people were trying to disrobe her. You know, while she was undergoing this humiliation in the court, she was looking defiant, as if she was ready to face anything. So she was an independent woman, she was looking defiant. But this kind of a woman, aggressive woman, independent-minded woman, Draupadi, was also changed by the hands of the authors, in the hands of the authors in the later sections. You know, she is becoming polite compared to her earlier projection. We find her more polite, more meek in the later sections of the epic. It also shows that the authors were trying to project women in conformity with the male-dominated patriarchal society. So this, we can understand that how social things are coming up. Now, another point that is also important for us to understand how Brahmins were getting more importance. Because we know that in society, Varna division is important. So we are also going to talk a little about the way the Brahmins or the priestly class were getting more importance in the society. And this was also a marker of social hierarchy. So here we find that Mahabharata in various sections are talking of the way the Brahmins are getting more importance. You know, they were continuously emphasizing on the principle of dana and dakshina on them. So they were actually claiming the lion's share of the danas that were given during sacrifices. And here we find that scholars are disagreeing on the importance of this particular aspect, you know, because we find Hopkins, whom we have already mentioned, Hopkins thinks that the priests were driven by a kind of self-interest, because we have already told you that the priests were emphasizing on performing sacrifices. And we all know that the sacrifices are occasions when the priests get a number of charities, danas. So Hopkins finds in that a kind of a self-interest of the priests. But when we are talking about Romila Thapar, Romila Thapar also agrees with Hopkins that there was a kind of self-interest hidden in the Brahmins. But she is also emphasizing that point that the priests were also performing a very important task of maintaining social order. They were trying to maintain a proper moral code in the society. They were trying to maintain the discipline in the society by looking at the way the women virtues of women are maintained, tolerance is followed in the society. So here we should mention that the priests were doing dual functions. They were fulfilling their demands for, you know, charity, that is true, but they were also fulfilling some other social demands. They were also catering to the needs of the society by maintaining discipline in the society. That is very important. Now, in the Mahabharata, we find when the authors, we all know that the authors were Brahmins, and when the Brahmin authors were writing the text, they were, some way or the other, they were trying to glorify the priests. You know, some priests are always being mentioned. They are mentioned occasionally at short intervals. Who are they? For example, I'll give you three names. Augusto, Vashishtha, Vishwamitra. These are a few names which are continuously being referred in the Mahabharata by the authors. How are they mentioned? You know, they are mentioned as having remarkable power. They are considered to be magical. They are considered to be holders of magical power. How? Because Augusta was described as so powerful that he was requested by the gods to dry up the ocean bed so that gods can go and fight the demons, you know, hiding there. So we can understand that gods are coming to the sage. Gods are, you know, considered to be inferior in power than the sage Augusta. We can understand that this was happening. And with regard to Vishwamitra and Vashishtha, we find that they were continuously, the kings were going to them for advice and counsel. So this is a very important matter which we have to keep in mind, that how the priests were glorifying the sages of ancient period. Now the question is, well, while we are talking about these kind of things, we are also going to talk about the way the priests were performing a very important social obligation that we have already mentioned, that they had some social obligation. What kind of social obligation are we mentioning? You know, by social obligation, we want to mean that the priests were actually trying to fulfill the need of a disciplined and well-ordered society. You know, so they were trying to, you know, come up with certain codes of conduct. Private morality, on public morality, on familial relationship, on marital relationship. We are getting number of references in the Mahabharata where the priests are coming up with certain kind of, you know, codes of conduct, which is important for the maintenance of a stable society. You know, here I'll give you two examples. First of all, in the fifth chapter, we all know about Vidura. Now, Vidura has a very long lecture in the fifth chapter on private morality. And in the third chapter, we have a conversation amongst Draupadi, Yudhishthira and Bhima on family relationship and moral, you know, family relationships, where moral issues were discussed and in which the niti of Brihaspati was also cited. So this is important for us to keep in mind, that the priests were actually fulfilling a very important task of maintaining social order, a stable social order. Now, coming to the list, Little Epic, Ramayana. What kind of social consciousness, what kind of caste consciousness is discerned in the Ramayana? You know, Ramayana too carries a number of, episodes by which we can understand that Brahmins were getting importance in the society and caste differentiation was there. For example, I'll give you one example, one very important instance. This is a story of Shambhuka. You know, Shambhuka was a Shudra by caste, in origin, by birth. But Shambhuka was leading the life of an ascetic. And because of this, being a Shudra as he was leading the life of an ascetic, he was beheaded by Rama. You know, we all know Rama is the custodian of morality, he's a just ruler. But Ram also beheaded Shambhuka for, practicing the life of an ascetic. It shows that caste differentiation was very, very well entrenched in the society. It did not permit a Shudra to lead the life of an ascetic. So it shows that how the Ramayana also, in certain instances, became very orthodox with regard to caste differentiation and social hierarchy in the society. Now, coming to the next point, this is also crucial for us. This is the religious milieu in the epics. While talking about the social life and cultural life of the epics, religion also forms a very important category. So we are going to mention in brief about the religious milieu as depicted in the two great epics. You know, in the Mahabharata, we find that while it was receiving a final shape, Vishnu was becoming important. Vishnu had already emerged as a personal deity by that time and replacing the Brahman of the Upanishads and the other Vedic gods. You know, in the Mahabharata, we don't find the Vedic gods Indra or Agni to be powerful. If you have any idea about the Vedic literature, you must be knowing that there, the largest number of Shuktas were actually ascribed to Indra and the second position was held by Agni. And here we find in the Mahabharata, Indra and Agni both were suffering humiliation in the hands of the Brahmin authors. Here, who is the most important deity? Here, Vishnu and Krishna, they are the most important deities. Krishna as the avatar of Vishnu is actually emerging as the most important deity. And with regard to Indra, we find that he was suffering from a sense of guilt and humiliation. And at one point of time, he was also robbed of his heavenly throne. So it shows that as the supremacy of Indra as the king of the gods was questioned in the Mahabharata. And then coming to the next god, Agni. Even the Agni, who is actually considered to be the friend of Indra, he also lost much of his glory in the Mahabharata, to the point that in some section of the Mahabharata, we have legends describing how because of Rishi Bhrigu's curse, he became the eater of all things and had to go into hiding. This is nothing but, an indication of the loss of importance of these two very important Vedic gods, Indra and Agni. So the older gods were actually reclining. They were actually going into, the background, and new gods were coming. So with regard to the new gods, certainly we must mention Vishnu and his incarnation, that is Krishna. So we are going to talk a little about the aspect of Vaishnavism in the epics. We all know in the epic Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita forms a very important part. This Bhagavad Gita it shows the immense power of Vishnu. And you'll be surprised to know that the Bhagavad Gita was inserted in the epic at the beginning of book 6. This was a little insertion. This does not form the original epic. This was included at a much later time. And book 6, at the introduction of which the Bhagavad Gita was inserted, there we find the description of the great fight. So book 6 is going to describe the great fight. At the beginning of that, suddenly Bhagavad Gita was inserted. And where we find the conversation between Krishna and Arjuna. And we all know that in the Mahabharata, Krishna is projected as a personal god, who is the creator, who is eternal, who is imperishable. And he commands obedience and support, devotion. And who is the human form Vishnu has taken on earth. So we find Krishna being very important in the epic Mahabharata. Now the question is, with regard to Bhagavad Gita, we have already told that keeping in mind the continuously developing importance of Vaishnavism, the Vaishnava authors thought of including Bhagavad Gita at the beginning of book 6. Now, with regard to Harivansha,
That is also, you know, a very important indication that Vaishnavism was rising in strength. Hari Vansha, look at the name. Hari Vansha, Hari is another name of Vishnu. Vansha means genealogy. Hari Vansha, which was added at the later, at the concluding part, as an appendix to the Mahabharata, here we find the genealogy of Hari. That is the life history and genealogy of Hari, that is Vishnu. So this also shows that in Mahabharata, Vaishnavism had become important. Therefore, separate chapters had to be included either at the beginning of certain chapters or at the end of Mahabharata to illustrate the glory or to glorify Vishnu. In Ramayana also, we find a similar kind of a picture. We find Rama was projected as the, you know, incarnation of Vishnu. So in both the epics, we find this kind of a development. So we are now going to talk about the classification of the Puranas. You know, traditionally, the Puranic literature is classified into two broad categories. One is the Mahapurana, or the major Puranas, and the other is the Upapurana, Upapuranic literature, or the minor Puranas. Traditionally, we have 18 Mahapuranas, and these Mahapuranas are again subdivided into three categories based on their quality. You know, the first category is Shatta category, that is the quality of light or purity. The second category is Rajas category, the Puranas which actually exemplify passion, the aspect of passion. And the third category is the Tamush category, that is the Puranas which basically talk about those things associated with darkness or inertia. Actually, unlike the Mahapuranas, the Upapuranas have a regional character. I'll give you of two, three examples, like for example, Kalika Purana of Assam or the Devi Purana of Bengal. So these are considered to be Upapuranas, which have a regional character. Now again, one very important thing is to discuss the time of the Puranas. When was the Puranic literature, was it composed? Now regarding the time of the Puranas also, we have several views, you know, coming from various scholars. They are not, you know, unanimous in their opinion. But here I'll talk a little about, I'll mention the book called Amarakosha's book, which has been cited by Professor R.C. Hajra. You must be knowing about R.C. Hajra. R.C. Hajra is the best, most important author. You know, he's a historian who has worked on the Puranic literature. And he has used Amarakosha, and he has discussed how in Amarakosha, a definition with regard to the Puranas have been given, where the Panchalokshmana theory has been enumerated. And what is more important for us to mention, two Puranas here. One is the Vishnu Purana and the other is the Markandeya Purana. You know, in the Vishnu and the Markandeya Purana, there is a mention of 18 Mahapuranas, but there is no mention of the Upapuranas. So we may presume that, we may infer that when the Vishnu and the Markandeya Puranas were written, that time the Upapuranic literature had not come into being. So this is important for us to mention time of the Puranas. Now, the most crucial question that we are now going to discuss are the factors that led to the rise of the Puranic culture. What was the reason for, you know, so many Puranas to come up during the Gupta period? Particularly from the Gupta period, we find the Puranic literature coming into shape. What are the factors? You know, there are various factors for the development of the Puranic culture, but we are going to talk about two factors mainly. One is a religious factor. The other is the socio-economic factor. Okay, I'll be discussing the religious factor. Here, I'll talk about the way religion provided an important, you know, incentive for the development of Puranic Hinduism. The first point that comes to our mind is the threat posed by the two most liberal religious traditions, that is Buddhism, particularly with its Mahayana variety, and Jainism. You know, they were much more liberal compared to Orthodox Vedic Brahminism, and, you know, Brahminism was losing grounds to them because they were carrying on their proselytizing activities in such an efficient manner. And they were also, you know, used as civilization building forces in Central India and Deccan. So to combat these two religions, Puranic Hinduism originated, can be said. Now coming to the second point, that is the socio-economic factors. What are the socio-economic factors we are finding associated with Puranic Hinduism? We know that in the Puranas, one particular phenomena that was being promulgated again and again was the principle of dana. You know, by dana and by mahadana, particularly the term mahadana that we are getting, it does not mean any ordinary dana or any ordinary charity. It means the charity or donation of land. So the Brahmins were actually to be given land donations, and by giving such donations, the king is going to earn more merit than is possible by the performance of Vedic sacrifices also. And you know, the kings who are most of the time they were rising from within the tribes. They were people from the autochthonous groups. So they were also looking for legitimation. By giving charity to the Brahmins, they were also getting legitimation of their newly earned status. So that is important for us. Actually, in the Puranas, we find that there was a very important development in the standard, in the position of the Brahmins. You know, there is a marked social ascendancy of the Brahmins, discerned in the Puranic literature. We find that the Puranas were, in the Puranas, the Brahmins were considered to be the lawgivers. They were the potent aides of the ruling class. And they were also, I have already mentioned you, that they were no longer confined to the role of teachers and, priestly performers. They were now having a new responsibility. They were now the landowners, because they had moved, by this, they had moved away from their previous age-old religious and academic activities. So the new socio-religious development, therefore, impacted on the hierarchical categorization of the class of the Brahmins. What are we meaning by that? What do we mean by this factor that they were impacting on the hierarchical categorization? Because you know, the new Brahmins were getting land donations in areas peripheral to the Madhya Desha region. They were getting land donations in regions like Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Bengal, Maharashtra. In the Puranas, one very important phenomena is the social ascendancy of the Brahmins. You know, the Brahmins were now having a new responsibility. They were no longer confined to their age-old practice of remaining priests or, you know, academicians. They were now also gaining some land donations from the kings. And I have already mentioned you that the land donations were given in peripheral regions which were not, you know, limited to the borders of Madhya Desha. These were all outlying regions like Andhra Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Odisha, Chhattisgarh. So they were moving from their original land to this, you know, peripheral lands. They were getting land donations and they were acting as landowners. So there were some kind of changes in their social role, social obligations. And one very important factor, you know, which we should mention, that there were certain new kinds of Brahmins that we are finding the mention of new kinds of Brahmins. For example, Shudra Brahmins, Chandal Brahmins, Mrecha Brahmins. What do they mean? What do they suggest? Actually, they signify that they were losing their ethnic purities by mixing up with the autochthonous people in the, you know, peripheral belts. They were losing their ethnic purity and they were also getting a number of new divisions, hierarchical divisions, in their fold. Now the question is, while we are talking about the Brahmins and the way the Brahmins were mixing up with the original settlers of the place, we should also mention how collective practices became important. What are the meaning of collective practices? Collective practices mean that the entire community is actually observing the practice. For example, you know, Professor Vijayanath, who has written a number of books on the Puranic period, she has written that vrata, collective vrata, japa, then going to tirthas, performance of collective pujas, performance of ritual bathing in holy rivers, which we call as snana, arrangement of oral recital of Puranas, that is katha, these were all becoming important. Why were they becoming important? Let me reiterate, they were becoming important because the Brahmin writers, or the Puranic writers, they were trying to, you know, bring into their fold the original settlers of the place, the tribal people of the place. So they were making arrangements for all kind of collective practices so that the difference actually bridges in. Here, we are going to talk about one very important phenomena without which the topic won't be complete about Puranic period, that is the Kali Yuga crisis. What is Kali Yuga crisis? You know, we have mentioned that when the new Brahmins were getting land donations in the far off places, that is the peripheral regions, they had to mingle with the original settlers because they wanted to bring all these original settlers within the fold of Brahminism. And while doing so, they had to admit of certain unacceptable tribal practices in the fold of Brahminism. And so they were doing it by promulgating the theory of Apatakalin Dharma. So they were telling that they were actually, you know, allowing those practices in periods of emergency. And they were also telling that this is a Kali Yuga, a very difficult period that has descended on us. Just because of that, we are allowing such unacceptable practices to be followed in our religion. And here I must mention that why was it a difficult period for Indian history? Because we all know that this was a period when the foreign invaders were coming. This was a period when, due to the decline of the Roman Empire, economic contacts with the Western world had also deteriorated. So we were banking more on agrarian factors. So socially, politically, economically, there were so many changes. There were so many difficulties that were being faced by the people of the country. And therefore, the Brahmins were promulgating the theory of the Kali Yuga crisis, that because of these difficulties, they were accepting certain unacceptable tribal practices in the fold of Brahminism, which is the Kali Yuga crisis. So another thing that is important, that is, in Puranic Hinduism, we find the development of some new deities. Various new deities were coming. Usually, we all know about five important deities, that is Brahma, that is Shiva, Vishnu, Devi, Ganesh and Surya. But in Puranic period, we are coming to know about so many new deities. Who are these new deities? I'll give you a few examples. Particularly with regard to Vishnu, we find that some avatars of Vishnu, some incarnation of Vishnu, like the Narasimha avatar or the Varaha avatar. We all know the Narasimha has half human, half animal. It's a theriomorphic image. Varaha is also the same. It is the human body with the face of a Varaha or a pig. So why are these deities coming into Puranic Hinduism? Because we can assume that they were actually totems of certain pre-literate groups who were staying in these peripheral regions. And in coming to terms with this ordinary people or the pre-literate people, the Brahmins were accepting their gods as the gods of the Brahmins. So some, this kind of totemic gods were also finding their way into Puranic Hinduism. There are many such examples, that we can provide, particularly with regard to Vishnu and with regard to Shiva also. The Ganas of Shiva, the Yakshas, they are all, belong to the pre-literate or the autochthonous groups who were considered to be important deities in the Puranic period. To sum up, let me give you some idea about the things that we have already mentioned about the epics and the Puranas. We have tried to discuss how the epics and Puranas had the same kind of origin. They were all bardic tales, and how the tales, the epics and the Puranas went through, series of transmutations, changes, interpolations to acquire their present shape. How it is very difficult for us to come to a certain period. We can't be specific about the time of its composition, neither can we say anything with certainty about the authorship of the epics and the Puranas. But even if the epics and Puranas have some inherent difficulties, like the inclusion of legendary accounts or myths getting enmeshed with the actual narratives, we can say with proper reading there are some historical insights that come up from the epics and the Puranas. For example, we have particularly emphasized on the aspect of society and cultural life as depicted in these two very important texts, and how with select reading, with corroborations from other sources, this can be immensely helpful to understand the socio-cultural life of India during the ancient times. For further details, you can please visit the website of ePathshala and look at the e-text. Thank you so much.